Mr. Chairman, Bar Council of Tamil Nadu, Vice Chairman of Bar Council of Tamil Nadu, and Co-Chairman of the Bar Council of India, and members of the Bar Council, all of my good young friends, not old friends, and I congratulate the office bearers of the Bar Council and elected members of the Bar Council for their successful election and occupying the position. This should have happened at least 1 year earlier. We are late almost by 1 year now, even after the election, for various reasons, legal issues. However, better late than ever, they have occupied the position and they have been inaugurated and sworn in into the office by the judge of the Supreme Court and very eminent judge of the Supreme Court, Justice Banuji herself, who never attends any function. Very rarely she comes at kind of functions, except judicial functions. And I am thankful to the Bar Council for giving me this opportunity. And more particularly, Mr. Balu, the chairman of the Enrolment Committee, who invited me to deliver the first lecture to the young lawyers who are going to be enrolled tomorrow. I thank him personally for giving me this opportunity. My dear learned friends, and I have great pleasure in addressing you as learned friends. You are all qualified in law, therefore you are learned. There are much more qualified persons who have got degree like postgraduate degrees, MPhil, PhD. They are not normally addressed as learned. It is only those who are learned in law are addressed learned. Today you are all my learned friends. By tomorrow, when you get yourself enrolled, and you will become my learned brothers and sisters. This has got a very, very important connotation, because the members of the professions is considered as a learned brother and sister. That relationship is one of the fundamentals of this legal profession, which you'd never forget. And I find a large number of lady advocates here, and I welcome them to the profession. When we got into law college, when I got into law college sometime in 1962, there are only 5 girls in the whole class, which contains more than 120 men students. Only 5 girls were there. They used to sit in one corner. And when we got enrolled, there were very few lady lawyers here. Now, in a short time to come, in another decade, there will be more lady lawyers than men lawyers. I think so. Because these more ladies will get into the law college and the competition by marks than men students. Because when you look at the results that's coming out, and it is only the ladies who are securing higher marks than the men students. Therefore, now the selection to the colleges may necessarily on the merit basis in the days to come, in every profession and every walk of life, there is going to be more ladies. And you will occupy more than 50% at a later point of time. It's good for the country, good for you, good for the family. And as a young lawyers looking for the profession of law, you are proceeding towards a new life. Law is a very challenging profession for a number of reasons. First of all, this is a long gestation profession. Unlike any other profession or any other employment, the day one you finished your college and got into a job or get into a profession, you start earning. But when you get into a profession of lawyers, you are not likely to earn, at least for quite few years, very difficult to earn money. Because for a young lawyer, no client will give a case. Because to handle a case, one should have an erudite and experience in law. One should be learned in law. One should have experience in law. And at this moment, I would like to recall one incident that happened in England. The King of England called the Chief Justice of England and directed him to decide a case in a particular fashion. The King of England is supreme. And he called the Chief Justice and said, you decide this case in the particular fashion. And the Chief Justice heard the case and decided differently. The king was very furious. Then the king summoned the Chief Justice to his court. Then when Chief Justice comes to the court of the King of England, the normal procedure is, anyone who comes to court will have to kneel before the king on his knees and put his face on the knees of the king. So when he kneeled before the Chief Justice, when kneeled before the king took out his sword, because every king used to have a sword, he took out his sword and put it on the neck of the Chief Justice. And this is reported in the Supreme Court judgment. This is one of the incidents that is said to have happened, real incident. He put the sword on the neck of the judge and he started questioning the Chief Justice. Mr. Chief Justice, will you please answer my questions? Who appointed you? Your Majesty appointed me. Who gave you the chair? Your Majesty gave you the chair. Who made the law? Your Majesty made the law. And who is ruling this country? Your Majesty is ruling the country. I have appointed you, you are my appointee. I delegated some of my judicial powers to you. You are only exercising a delegated power. You are only my agent. And I made the law. It is my law that you are administering. I rule the country of which you are the Chief Justice on my nomination. When I directed you to decide a case, you have not decided the case in the manner I wanted you to decide. Why you have not decided the case as I directed you? The king asked. The Chief Justice answered, to decide a dispute between the citizens, one should be erudite in law. One should be learned in law. One should have experience in law. Without learning in law, without experience in law, one cannot decide. Your Majesty might have made the law, but Your Majesty is not erudite in law. It's like our parliament members. They are all making laws and they are not really erudite in law, because many of them do not even read. That's a problem today. Your Lordship made, your Majesty made the law, but you have not read all the laws, because you are not carrying on the profession of law. Only those who carry on the profession of law will be very learned in law. You are not carrying on the profession, therefore you are not learned in law. And you have not practiced law, therefore you have no experience in law. Men and matters and interpretation of law you will not know. Therefore your decision I cannot absorb and do that. That's why I decided. The king again asked, it is I who made the law. Do you think I do not know the law? Most of the law is common sense, your morality. Do you think the king doesn't know the common sense and morality? It is I, the embodiment of all morals of the state, and I directed you to decide. The Chief Justice still said, unless you are learned in law, practiced in law, experienced in law, your decision I cannot take. The moment you appoint me a judge, I have to judge. Then the moment I do not judge myself, then I cease to be a judge. If I decide as Your Majesty would have directed me, then by the time I decide that case in the manner Your Majesty would have said, then I cease to be a judge. Then I cannot decide this case. Ultimately, after a long conversation, there is a two controversial statements are there. The king killed the chief justice on one hand. There's some story. Ultimately, the king left the chief justice and he went away. Why I am narrating this anecdote to you is that you should become learned in law. If you want to practice in law, you have to be learned in law. You have to read a lot. Those days when we joined the college, it should be said. And my professor, my professor Arunachalam, the constitutional expert, used to say, the first class when I entered, he addressed the constitution class. My dear young man, most of them are only men. My dear young man, I tell you today, you are here since you cannot be anywhere else. Because you have secured so low marks, you will not get admission in medical college, engineering college, or agricultural college. Therefore, the law college is the only college open to all who have not secured very low marks. But not the case with you today. You all secured high marks. After a very competitive examination, you have joined here. Therefore, you have the basic intelligence, basic ability to read, understand, and assimilate. But only thing is, you'll have to work hard to learn law. Learning law is a continuous reading throughout life. Sometimes I used to think, I could have read well when I was in college, I would not have come to the profession. And read all day, all through my years, till I am almost 80 now. Till 80 years I'll have to read. I could have read at least 18 years, 20 years in the college and school. I would have got some other profession, like my father is a doctor. I need not have read so much. But today, to be a lawyer, you have to read day and night. Unless you read all laws very detailedly, very carefully, and try to understand them, then you will not become learned in law. Then you should practice law. If you practice law, you will have to be sincere to the profession. Unless you are sincere to the profession, you will not have the experience in law. The experience requires that tomorrow after enrollment, you should not put up a board and start practicing. That you can never do. You should go and join some other senior lawyer who have got enough and more cases and good practice and learn from him the practice of law. Only if you learn from him the practice of law and you will have the experience in law. But I tell you today, the law is one of the best professions. Absolutely independent. You are accountable to your conscience and to your client and to the judge. You are not accountable to anything. You have got an absolute independence to carry on this profession. Therefore, this is one of the best professions. If you do well in the profession, you can earn enough money for yourself and your family. You may not be able to amass wealth like a big businessman or a politician, but still enough money to make your life happy and comfortable. This is one of the best professions. Unlike any employment, you have got a fixed salary. This profession, if you do well, you can prosper well, even in financial. And amongst you, there are several subordinate judicial officers, there are several high court judges, and tomorrow you can become Supreme Court judges. I think some of you will become Supreme Court judges, some of you will become high court judges, some of them will become subordinate judges, some of them will become a top executives. And therefore, the life is a very plentiful and a very challenging life is ahead of you. You accept the profession with all happiness. You continue your life with all confidence, self-confidence. You can do well in the profession. The profession is essential for functioning of Indian democracy, because Indian democracy is essentially based on rule of law and based on the constitution tenets. If the constitution is to be upheld for the well-being of the whole nation, it is the constitution is in your hands today. If you are going to administer the constitution, explain the constitution, decide in accordance with the constitution tomorrow as judges of the High Court, Supreme Court and other judiciary. Therefore, the whole country will have to look to you. The whole country will have to look to you for your guidance and for your support to sustain the Indian democracy and constitutional democracy is in your hands. Don't think law profession is a very small or insignificant or unimportant profession. The most important profession in a democracy is the legal profession. It all depends upon how hard you work, how industrious you are. More industrious you are, more prosperous. Mr. Vidudale is there, a very erudite lawyer from the Supreme Court, former Advocate General of the State, and all these Bar Council members, they're all eminent lawyers, and you can also become eminent lawyers. But so far as a lawyer is concerned, certain basic things you should never deviate. Basic things in life. First of all, as a lawyer, you should be well-dressed. Please understand that. Don't try to teach me the fundamentals, I have to tell you. Because as the days go by, some of the lawyers start neglecting themselves. They neglect themselves and neglect their dress tool. And they neglect their garments in professional law. They neglect. I do not want any one of you to do that. In this world, as it is rightly said in our language, all paadi, aadai paadi. All paadi, aadai paadi. You are respected for the dress you have, proper dress. So therefore, every lawyer should be properly dressed at all times, whether he is found inside the court or outside the court. First, everywhere you will be recognized, so-and-so is a lawyer, so-and-so is an advocate. As an advocate, he should be well-dressed everywhere. You should not neglect that. And if you are not properly dressed, society will not respect you. That's the most fundamental. You should polish your shoes, clean your chappals, wash your clothes correctly, and groom your hair, shave your face if you are a man, and always tidy and properly dressed. That's most important. A lawyer. You will have to wear your robes properly. Whenever you go to the court, you properly wear your robes. Have a clean band, have a clean collar, have a clean coat, have an uncrushed gown. You should wear it properly, and proper dress is very necessary for a lawyer. Only then your client will respect you. Only then the judge will respect you. Only a well-dressed man, well-dressed lawyer is respected in the court. If you are shabby, if you are clumsy and look like a buffoon, no judge will respect you. No client will respect you. So therefore, you should be well-dressed. That's the most fundamental for every lawyer. And never neglect it throughout your life. Never neglect it throughout your life. This is my one very fundamental request, because many of the lawyers are not properly dressed. You should wear the robes, especially the band and the gown, the band and the gown, I am very particular, the band and the gown, only in court premises. If you are wearing a band, you should wear it only in the court premises. You should found wearing a band, a lawyer's band, and a lawyer's gown, only in the court premises, nowhere else. You should not wear a band and a gown and go to a cinema theater. Don't go to a hotel. If you have to go to a hotel, at least remove your band, remove your coat, remove your gown. Keep it in your hand, go to the hotel, because you have no other place to keep it. If you have a place to keep it, leave the robes outside and go to place. Do not wear gown and band. Identify as your lawyer elsewhere. When you are traveling the bus, don't wear a band and a gown and travel. So I find some of the lawyers are doing that, which should never be done. The band and the gown is the dress of a lawyer, which should be worn only in your court premises, not outside. Never forget that. You should maintain a very cordial relationship with your fellow members of the bar. That's very, very important. This is one important profession where the opponent sides are together always. You and your opponent lawyer can go to a hotel together, go to a cinema theater together, go and attend a marriage together. They are opponent to you. You should maintain utmost respect to fellow members of the bar. Never quarrel with them, but fight with them in the court hall by argument, not abusing them personally. No. No lawyer should comment upon the other side lawyer personally. You can only argue your case. And however vehemently you can argue your case, you can make a statement of fact, statement of law, and argue your case vehemently in your court of law. You can even tell the judge, my learned friend is wrong. Don't forget to say, my learned friend is wrong. Don't call him by name. You should respect your opponent lawyer. That's very important. Only if you respect your opponent lawyer, the opponent lawyer will respect you. That's why I said you are a learned friends, and tomorrow you are going to become learned brothers and sisters. You should continue to have that relationship, learned brother and sisters, in the profession. Then only there will be a cordial atmosphere in the court premises. You should not be fighting with each other. Then how will you carry on your profession? So therefore, the court premises should have very cordial relationship between the judge and the lawyers, and the lawyer and the lawyer. That is very important. That depends upon your behavior. Your respect your fellow member of the bar. You should always go and help your fellow member whenever he is in need. You should assist him. When you assist him, they will assist you. You belong to one class. You belong to one family. The legal fraternity. The legal fraternity should be always together. And we may argue cases for and against. That doesn't mean we'll become enemy. The moment we come out of the court hall, we are friends. We may fight in the court hall as much as we want, not outside. This you never forget. That's why maintain utmost cordiality, courtesy, friendship, respect for the fellow members of the bar. That's very fundamental. Then you should respect the judicial officers. You have a place in society because you are a lawyer appearing before a judicial officer. If you are not appearing before a judicial officer, you are not respected. Then you'll have to sit in your office, be a solicitor, going on drafting documents, sale deeds, and other documents. Lawyer profession is one, especially in India. A lawyer, an advocate, he can act and plead. He can act for and on behalf of the party, act for and on behalf of the party, and also plead for and on behalf of the party before a court of law or a tribunal. In England, they are divided it in two. A person who is acting is called a solicitor. A person who is pleading is called a barrister. So in India, under the Advocates Act, an advocate is both a solicitor as well as a barrister. You are doing job both. It has got a lot of importance. So if you want to do the job as a practicing lawyer, appearing before a court of law, then you should respect your presiding officer. The judges of the court, be it a subordinate judge, or the High Court judge, or the Supreme Court judge, or any other tribunal. As a judge, as a presiding officer of a judicial forum, as a quasi-judicial forum, they command lot of respect from public. Because it is the judicial officers who decide the destiny of others. Right, liberty and property of others, right, liberty and property of others are decided only by the judicial officers. So they have such a power and you are going to practice before them. You are going to be very close to them. So long you are a practicing lawyer before a court of law, you will have respect. If the court of law should have respect, the lawyers who are very near them should respect them first. If we do not respect the judge, who will respect the judge? If the judge do not command a respect, how will they give you respect as a person practicing before that court? A respectless judge cannot create respect to a lawyer who pleads before him. He will be equally unimportant and not a respectful person. The judges are all respected. You see, wherever you go, the judges are all respected. And we are close to the judges as lawyers. Therefore, we are also respected. Our respect in society depends upon the respect of the judge in the society. So you should respect the judges. So you should maintain utmost cordial relationship with the judges. If you do not respect a judge, then there will be no cordial relationship. If there is no cordial relationship, you cannot carry on your profession properly. There is one thing, don't forget. Even though he may be a judge, nevertheless he is a human being. It is only human beings who are judges, who are brothers and sisters yesterday, today become a judges. So therefore the judges are also human beings. So they have all the defects and credits wherever they go. Don't expect the moment he goes and sits in the chair, he cannot become a perfect human being. He may wear the judge's gown, judge's coat, judge's chair. Merely because he went and said that, he will not become a flawless person tomorrow. He will have all flaws. Don't try to find flaws in the judge and try to disrespect him. You will have to bear with the flaws of the judge. That first you learn that. Don't forget that the judge is also a human being. Every human being will have flaws. The judge will also having a flaws. Merely because the judge has got a flaws, I will not respect you. I will criticize you. I will abuse you. I will disregard you. Then you disregard them, judges will lose respect. Then judges lose respect, you will also lose respect. The client won't respect you. So therefore you should, in all humility, respect the judge. Don't try to find fault with the judge and to discredit the judge. Judge may make mistakes. If he makes mistakes, you can always file an appeal. Don't quarrel with the judge. Therefore, every lawyer should respect a judicial officer. And he should not make an unnecessary claim, unnecessary complaint against judicial officers. Sometimes it becomes a practice of some lawyers go on writing complaints against judicial officers to the High Court. You should not go on writing complaints. And the Bar Association is always there. If you have got any difficulties, go and tell the Bar Association President, Bar Council Chairman, these people are there. And they will interact with the judges wherever it is wrong and they will set it right. You should always have a representative action rather than an individual action. This is a collective bargaining of a professional requirement, not an individual bargaining of a professional requirement. If you start one by one to one fight with the judge, then that is not proper. If you have got any difficulties, a judge is not accommodating a lawyer for an adjournment or passing erratic orders, then you take it up with the Bar Association. Bar Association will take up your case, Bar Council will take up your case wherever necessary, and the matter can be brought to the appropriate authorities, and then even the High Court judge or Supreme Court judge, as the case may be, the defect can be rectified. If you start quarreling one to one, there is another difficulty for you. If you are friendly with the judge, he will hear your argument in full, pass an order whenever you deserve an order. If you quarrel with the judge, even if you deserve an order, he will not give you the order. Because he is a human being. If he abuse you, he will not benefit me. You cannot expect a judge, even though I abuse the judge, he should decide cases perfectly and correctly. How do you expect him? He is also a human being. All right, you abused me, you ill-treat me, you disrespect me, I will decide the case against you. Go and appeal. If the judges passes adverse orders against your clients, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it will come to become the knowledge of the entire town or city or the bar. Oh, this man is not in good terms with the judge. Therefore, if you go to him as a lawyer, and he will only pass the adverse orders, no clients will come to you. So therefore, it is in your own interest, do not quarrel with the judge. It may be in one case the judge is not favorable to you. In the another case, the judge may be favorable to you. Because in one judge I have lost, one case I have lost, therefore I cannot go and attack a judge. That is not the way a lawyer should behave. I am not just saying that. I am practicing it that for 54 years. I am 54 years as on date in the profession. I have never quarreled with a judge. I have never fought with a judge. Never fought with a judge. I have appeared before hundreds of high court judges and several states all over the country. I never had any problem. You should know how to accommodate a judge, how to respect a judge. The moment you know that, then you have no difficulty. There is a third interest in that. If you quarrel with the judge, if you go on getting an adverse order from the judge, how will you be happy? Can you be happy? You are losing all your cases, losing all your clients. And losing all your clients, losing all your cases, it may be you are losing a case, but so far as that case is concerned, that client is concerned, it is life and death. Because you are quarreling with the judge, your client is going to suffer. You quarrel with the judge, you suffer. That's understandable. But so far as the judge is concerned, he cannot punish you personally. He can only punish you through your client, deciding the case adversely against you. Not granting an adjournment, not granting an order, not granting stay, not granting an injunction. Because of you, your client is going to suffer. It is your duty to protect the interest of the client. Without protecting the interest of the client, you go on quarreling with the judge. Then ultimately your client suffers. It is his right, liberty and property will be staked before a court. So do not do that. So far as the client and the lawyer is concerned, you should have a proper relationship with him. You should not get yourself identified as a client. First and foremost, you know, the clients have 100 problems. You are a lawyer, he is a client. Client and the lawyer, there is a gap. Never fail to maintain the gap between you and the client. Do not identify yourself. Do not step into the shoes of the client. Never do that. He is a client, treat him as a client. And read well, prepare well, go and argue sincerely. That's the only duty. Don't identify yourself as a client and then go and represent yourself as a client. No, never start doing that. Then if you start doing that, and you are likely to make many mistakes. You are likely to overreach your position as a lawyer, and that's where the quarrel starts. That's where the petition starts. That's where you start making adverse comments against judges. That comes to the ear of the judges. So therefore, never overstep into the shoes of your client. And client should be kept at a respectable distance from you. Don't yourself become a client. When the client comes to you, your relationship should be properly designed. What is the case? What is the fees? How much time it will take? How many hearings we may have to go? All these things you will have to calculate. It is very difficult, I know. How long the case will take, how many hearings you will have to attend, all these things visualize in advance and fix a fee is difficult. I know that. But nevertheless, the client should know what is your fees. Because you do not know how many hearings I may have to go, how many hours I will have to read, how much preparation I will have to do, how much writing I will have to do, how many pages I will have to get it typed, how many times I will have to correct them. All these things you may not know. Still your client also doesn't know that. So client doesn't know, you do not know. What is the fees in between? How do you fix it? Anyway, you have by experience, you will have to assess your fees and tell him in advance. without telling him what will be your fees, present fees, future fees, in one term or two terms or three terms, you will have to give him some idea what is your fees. Without giving him an idea what is your fees, you accept an engagement, tomorrow that will create a lot of problems. The client will think you are asking more fees and you will be thinking you are getting only less fees. And that will give room to a lot of complaint to the bar council. And you will have to come here as a before the bar council for professional misconduct. I do not want any one of you to come to this building after enrollment. Tomorrow shall be the last and the final time you enroll the bar council. If you enroll, come to the bar council. You should come to bar council as a chairman, vice chairman, national representative, members, and to deliver lectures. Not under any complaint. I don't want you. I don't wish that. I know you will not do that. I have confidence in you. Please maintain a good professional conduct and tell the client what will be your fees. At least tell me tentative fees. This will be the fees you may have to pay. And collect the fees and argue the case. If he is a poor client, you can charge less. If he is a rich client, quite often comes to me, I charge a huge fees. It all depends. Big clients will come to you. If you work hard, read more, do well. This is something like a snowballing. In the snowy mountains, a small stone starts falling from that. A small stone from the top of the snowy mountain. As he rolls the slopes of the mountain, it gets more and more and more and more of the snow. It will become a big snowball when it comes down. The profession is like that. When you are on the top of it and you have got the better chance of rolling down faster and faster and collecting more and more snow. But you'll have to wait for that. Overnight you can't achieve that. Every one of you, I find many of the senior advocates here, erudite senior advocates here, attorney generals, advocate generals, government leaders. Everyone has got a place in this profession. You have got a very prosperous profession. Be confident about that. But one more thing I'll have to tell you. When there appears some difference of opinion between the client and the lawyer, the first thing you should do, here is your case, here is your fees, take it and go away. Whatever work you might have done, the moment there is a difference of opinion between the lawyer and the client, never entertain the client directly, because that will create a lot of problems and needless complaints. Doesn't matter whatever fees you have received, you can even return it to them. And case bundle also is returned to them. Go and find a lawyer of your choice, because every client has to find a lawyer of his choice. The moment you cease to become his chosen lawyer, that was originally chosen lawyer, later point of time non-chosen lawyer, don't continue with him. Return the case papers and the money. And no lawyer can retain the papers, case papers, for the unpaid fees. Please understand that. The client has agreed to give you X fees. He has given you X minus fees. You have done a lot of work for him. There is a difference of opinion. He is refusing to pay the fees. You don't tell him, unless you pay the balance of fees for the work I have already done, I will not return the bill. You have no right. Your case papers are not property. The case papers are not a property which you can retain, like a mortgage, like an hypothecation. No. Whether fees is paid or not, you are bound to return the case papers to the client. That is the duty of every lawyer. Never forget that. Whether you received the fees or not, for the work you have done, the moment client wants the case papers, please return the papers without any murmur. And take it in writing that he has received the entire papers. Take it in writing without fail that he has taken back all the papers. If you don't take it in writing, tomorrow he will come and say, no, my papers are not given to me. You will have to come and stand before the bar box for professional misconduct. Never do that. As a lawyer, you may receive money from your client for two things. One, towards your fees, which you can make use of it. If you have received any money towards expenses, if you received any money towards expenses, you are bound to maintain an account for that. What is the expenses for which you have received money? What is the expenses you have incurred? What is the balance you have? If you do not maintain a proper account for the money received from the client towards expenses, tomorrow that will become a room for complaint. So therefore, whatever money you receive towards your fees, whatever money you receive by way of expenses, you kindly keep them separately and under an account. You always get it, record it, what is your fees, what is the expenses. There are many cases like that, the so-and-so advocate has received fees because the client sometimes may not know the difference between the fees and expenses. All right, I paid him 10,000 rupees. He thinks that all of them is fees. Perhaps you might have spent 9,000 rupees towards a court fee stamp. You would have got only 1,000 rupees for you. So the client may not know that he thinks according to him you paid 10,000 rupees. 9,000 rupees were already spent. You would have got only 1,000 rupees. So therefore keep an account, keep the client fully informed. What is the expenses, what is the fees? So therefore there should be no dispute over that. There is no lack of information. There shall be no information gap between the client and the lawyer. These are all the areas we'll have to do it. And as a lawyer, you have a duty to society. And that society duty is to do legal aid to the poor. Whenever you get a chance to legal aid to the poor, you do it voluntarily, willingly and happily. Not that everyone will get an opportunity to do legal aid. Whenever there is an opportunity to do a legal aid, to some poor person wants a legal advice, legal services, appearance before a court of law, defend him, always do that. Every lawyer has got a duty to do legal aid. That is essential because in this country, rich and poor should have justice. The justice system is not for the rich alone. The moment the justice system becomes the captive of the rich alone, and the country democracy cannot survive. So it is our duty to do service to the poor whenever an opportunity is coming, whenever a call is given either by the judge, sometimes the judge himself may say, all right, you do it in amicus curiae and argue for him, do it free. We'll have to do that. Quite often it happens in the criminal court, lesser it happens in the civil court. So you will have to do some legal aid to the poor. Some of them will turn out to be criminal lawyers, some of them will turn out to be civil lawyers. If you happen to become a criminal lawyer one day, please be more careful. Because your clients are criminals. Criminal accused of being criminals. Don't believe that they are criminals, they are innocent. So far as the criminal case is concerned, every accused is presumed to be innocent. You are duty bound to defend the criminal, even if you are a murderer. Do not substitute your knowledge or information and then decide his case. No, he has committed the murder. You don't say. That is not your business. Whether a person is to be convicted in a court of law as per the Indian law is on the basis of evidence, not on the basis of faith and belief. It is not faith and belief that matters. Many of you may not know, when I entered this bar, there is one court called a small causes court. The beautiful building is there, even today there is a small causes court is there. There was one court called legal oath court. Legal oath. If you go to that court, the judge will be sitting in front of a table. There will be a table, will be there. And there will be a Quran, there will be a Gita, there will be a camphor, there will be Bible. This is invariably decided in money suits of a particular value. So the plaintiff will come and challenge the defendant. Let him, if he is a Hindu, let him put out the camphor. The camphor will be lit. Let him put out the camphor. If he put out the camphor and says, no, I have not received the money, or you have repaid the money, he need not pay, I will go away. Either he pays the money or he puts out, it has to be watched. If he happens to be a Muslim, he said, let him take oath on the Quran that he has not received the money or repaid the money. Or if he is a Christian, on the Bible. The cases will go on, decided. If the challenge is made, yes, I have paid the money. If he comes and says, I have not received the money, the case is decided and the defendant is acquitted, he will go away. Many of them won't do that. There was faith. There was fear. That was the decision by faith. Tomorrow when you become criminal lawyer, you don't go by your faith whether he is a criminal, whether he has committed the offense or not. You have to put out the best case possible, argue the best evidence available, and do your best for the cross-examination. Make out a case for your client, most sincere. One thing I want to warn all the criminal lawyers, never forget. When you start cross-examining a witness, do not overstep your authority of a lawyer. Your client would tell you, ask this question, ask that question, in order to defame him or to settle a score with him. Going on inducing you, you ask this question, sir, you ask all these questions. Don't ask all these questions. You shall not overstep when cross-examining the witnesses in your court hall, either a civil court or a criminal court. Quite often it happens in the criminal court. Don't overstep. The court is not a legislature, state legislature or parliament. Please bear in mind. The court is not a state legislature or parliament. You can speak anything you want, still get away with that. No. You speak in the state legislature or parliament, you have got an absolute immunity. Nobody can proceed against you what you spoke in the parliament or in the state legislature. You have an absolute immunity. You have got a total freedom of speech, total and absolute freedom of speech on the floor of the legislature. But that is not in the court. If you overstep and ask unnecessary questions and defame your witness, the witness can proceed against you for defamation, the lawyer. The witness can proceed against the lawyer for defamation, for asking a defamatory question which is not relatable to the case, not necessary for the case. So you have to be very careful, because don't succumb to the client's request. Go on asking questions, whatever your client wants, that should never do that. And as a lawyer, you have to prepare your case very carefully, your plain written statement, complaint, all these things. This is very, very important. And you have got books on pleadings. Read them well. Prepare your case well. There are many, many more etiquettes and ethics which a lawyer has to observe. I do not have all the times, but there are a small pamphlet the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry has produced. I think you give them a copy free. I think you kindly go through it. And it contains what you should do, what you should not do. Do's and don't do's are found there. And you kindly have it in your table always. At least read it once in a month, never forget. So that you will not overstep as a lawyer. All these things I am telling you because I have got great love and affection for you as youngsters. And I want all of you to be happy throughout your life. If you want to be happy throughout your life, you shall not make mistakes. You shall not err. Be careful in whatever you do. Whenever we overstep, whenever we exceed our limits, and the proportionality, what we should do, what we should not do, then we come to grief. So I wish you a very, very bright career as a lawyer. The profession of lawyer is a very learned profession, very erudite profession, most respected profession. Be proud that you are a lawyer. First of all, you should feel proud that you are a lawyer. You should command respect in the society. It is the lawyers who made India. It is the lawyers who made India. Mahatma Gandhiji is a lawyer. Jawaharlal Nehru was a lawyer. Vallabhbhai Patel is a lawyer. Rajendra Prasad is a lawyer. Rajagopalachari was a lawyer. Subramanyam was a lawyer. Venkatraman was a lawyer. And many more throughout the country. Vallabhbhai Patel was a lawyer. And it is they who won freedom for you. It is the lawyer's voice that is being heard throughout the nook and corner of this country. If you behave well, if you conduct well, if you enrich your knowledge, and the society will respect you. If the society respects you, then you will be very, very happy and respectful. I wish you all success. I wish you all happiness. May you have a very happy family. And send your children back. Send your children back to the profession. Good luck.